Jimmy Connors plays VJ Armitage in the $200,000 WCT Invitational Saturday night at 8 on WSNS TV44 Chicago.
The On Deck Show with Harry Caray is brought to you by H&A Insurance. For car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance, call the people who live up to your expectations.
It's a beautiful day for baseball. Hello again, everybody. This is Harry Caray at Comiskey Park. Our guest on the pregame show, the manager of the Detroit Tigers, Sparky Anderson. Sparky, we not only had a great fight in Montreal last night, but a pretty good one here at Comiskey Park.
Yeah, we did, Harry. I liked your comments when you said it's Pearl Harbor.
Well, I tell you, I've been in fights. You've been in fights. Many of them, I guess. All of us have been. It's just so unusual to see a man attack a man from the rear with no provocation of the moment.
Well, they asked me, you know, Harry, what Detroit and Chicago, is this going to be bad words in that? I said no, because this wasn't Detroit and Chicago. This was Texas and Kansas City last night. It had nothing to do with the Chicago White Sox. It had nothing to do with the Detroit Tigers.
Sparky, you talk much about the character and the discipline and the kind of upstanding young men that you want on your ball club. How do you reconcile with something like happened last night?
I think you have to look farther and deeper into it. I think the young man feels very strongly that he was purposely hit when Farmer was at Texas. I do not know. I know Ed well. Ed comes at home. I played in the golf tournaments with him. So I do not judge Ed Farmer. I certainly do not judge Al Cowens. But Al feels very strongly that he was hit intentionally. So if you feel this, it'll weigh on your mind. And I think us as individuals, it's none of our business what people have in their mind, but they have to get it off. And I think now it's over as far as Al's concerned, and I'm sure it's over as far as Ed's concerned.
You know, though, if there's a year for this to fester, and if you feel this strongly about a guy you think hitting you intentionally, aren't you going to do something about it? Aren't you going to challenge him rather than sneak up there when he's looking out towards shortstop?
Well, I think you have to look at it both ways. If you're up hitting, you're not suspecting that either, to get hit in the jaw. And I think that if you feel in your mind that it was intentional, then under those circumstances, I think then you'd have to think that was a sneak thing.
Do you think that there's anybody who plays Major League Baseball that honestly believes a pitcher is trying to hit him in the jaw?
I honestly believe there are people that have honestly hit people. Whether in that incident it was, I have no way of knowing. But I do know and have played with people that have intentionally cold-cocked people.
Well, I find it hard to believe. I know the pitchers have thrown at guys. I know they've tried to get them away from the plate. I know they have hit them, but never with the idea of breaking their jaw or killing them.
Well, I don't think we ever think of that. But when we even talk about throwing at a man, you know, when you talk about throwing at a man, we can be varying from an inch to a half inch, and we're getting that close. If that ball takes off a little more than you expected, what do you think if it hits? It's going to break something.
We're talking with Sparky Anderson, the manager of the Tigers. We'll be back for more following this.
Hi, I'm Ted Albrecht of the Chicago Bears, and I'm part of a team 6 months out of the year. But the rest of the time, I'm a businessman, completely on my own. That's why I'm glad I have year-round protection of my H&A policy. H&A gave me good rates, friendly service, and they're there when I need them. So take some good business advice from me and put an H&A broker on your team today.
For car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance, call H&A today for a quote, 322-2100.
Harry Caray back at the ballpark with our guest Sparky Anderson, manager of the Detroit Tigers. Sparky, on the pregame show on radio, I manager Tony La Russa of the White Sox, and I asked him about the seven-day suspension, and he thought it was awfully weak, awfully light, and he thought that it might open the gates to a lot of further trouble if a stronger ruling wasn't made by the league president. What's your feeling about it?
My feeling is this, Harry, and I've been around a little longer than Tony, maybe not too much longer, but a little longer, and I've learned a long time ago the commissioner of baseball runs baseball, and then Lee McPhail runs American League, and Chubb Feeney runs the National League. I believe they're very confident or they wouldn't be there. I try to do this. I try to manage my club in that dugout. I don't try to run this league.
You know, I've seen a lot of fights, and you have too, on the baseball field. Usually they're just sort of polite little wrestling matches. But let me tell you something. There were some pretty good shots taken last night.
Yeah, they talked about that Durant and Sugar fight. I think that last night it was a pretty good, maybe a little better match.
You know, Tony La Russa's had a dislocated shoulder, and Tony has got a sharp fuse of a temper, and I think it's kind of fortunate maybe that his shoulder is bothering him, because he wasn't as prominent in that fight as he normally would be. But I noticed that he was trying to hold somebody off, and you were walking towards him. Now, I knew that, you being the gentleman you are, and Tony being the gentleman that is, there's no way that you two guys were getting the fight. It looked to me like you might have said, hey, Tony, what are we doing out here?
Tony did a super job in that thing last night. And when I got there, he was yelling, let's get them apart. And really, Tony did a great job. I think their coaches, Winkles, Bobby Winkles and Lauren Babe, Alex Grandma's for us. I don't think the coaches have any business ever taking a shot. Now, one coach last night, never mentioned it, took a shot. Now, that to me is totally uncalled for. That's the players. They can do all the wailing the way they want. No manager or coach should ever take a shot at a player.
You know, it's a funny thing. When you have a brawl like that, the stories of the blind shots. But I guess when you have a free-for-all, somebody's going to be hit blind.
Yeah, I never. Montreal and Philadelphia had a fight over Carlton, a throwing thing with Tim Foley, when he hit Foley and Mock, and they almost killed Mock in that fight.
Did you say anything to your team after the game or during the interim, right after the scuffle? Was there anything that you said at all?
Right after the scuffle, I told them to shut their mouths and sit down, and we're going to leave the fans alone and stay back under, because the fans right at this moment are hometown fans. They're doing nothing wrong. All they're doing is getting a little excited. Leave them alone. One guy poured beer all over my head. The guy said, how can you take that? I said, look, that man didn't do nothing. He poured some beer on my head. He's just showing he's a White Sox fan. There ain't nothing wrong with that.
Sparky, a million thanks for, as always, a most interesting interview, and I appreciate you talking so frankly about the situation. Thanks for being our guest. Now, today, let's just have a lot of thrilling baseball and not so many fisticuffs.
Well, I just want the fans to know Ed Farmer's a fine person and Al Cowens a fine person.
Okay, thank you very much. Sparky Anderson has been our guest on the pregame show. It's a beautiful afternoon for baseball. We're going to be out in the center field bleachers. Jimmy Piersall is already now with the starting lineups. Harry Caray down on the field, inviting you to stay with us for exciting Chicago White Sox baseball. So long, everybody. Guests on the pregame show will receive a Baum and Mercier men's dress watch, courtesy of Henry K. Jewelers, who are located at 547 North Michigan Avenue and on the third level of Water Tower Place.
Hi, everybody. Jimmy Piersall here at Comiskey Park on a beautiful Saturday afternoon. Pretty good crowd on hand. Boy, they've got 500 Chicago old-timers at the Baseball Association here this afternoon. They've got 100 of Baseball Association from Milwaukee, the guests of the Chicago White Sox at the ballgame. This is the second game of a four-game series, and as you all probably heard last night, it was quite an exciting ball game, and the fight even better than Durant and Leonard, if you happen to be at the ballpark, because you didn't see any pictures in the paper, because for some reason the Sun-Times doesn't think it's too much interesting to come out to the ballpark, and you may see something happen. As you know, that paper rips when it opens anyways. So the starting lineup for the Detroit Tigers, Jim Lentine will be in left field. He'll lead it off. Alan Trammell will bat second. He'll be at shortstop. Steve Kemp will be the designated hitter. He'll bat third. Lance Parrish will be behind the plate. Cowens will not play today. He is back in Detroit. He got a mild 7-day suspension. John Wockenfuss will be at first base. Champ Summers will be in right. Tom Brookens, who was thrown out of the ballgame before it almost even started last night, is at third base. He'll try it again this afternoon. Dave Stigman will be in center field, and Lou Whitaker will be at second base. And on the mound, it'll be Milt Wilcox. For the White Sox, Thad Bosley will lead it off. He'll be in left field. Todd Cruz, who had three hits last night, will be at shortstop. Harold Baines is in the third slot. LaMarr Johnson will be at first base. He's still bothered by a finger that he got a little break in it, but he's being able to play with it. Molinaro will be in the designated hitter slot. Chet Lemon will be in center field. Jim Morrison at second base. Bruce Kim will be behind the plate. Greg Pryor will be at third base. He was telling me his wife is feeling much better since they had that accident in Montreal. She's still in the hospital, and we wish her well. And on the mound, it'll be Ross Baumgarten. with a record of 1-3 for the White Sox, and I'll be right back to talk about the pitchers right after this message. Before I talk about the pitchers, Francisco Barrios has been farmed out to Iowa, and Hoffman has been returned, the left-hander. And Barrios, very unhappy young man this afternoon. He don't like it at all. Baumgarten, with a record of 1-3, an ERA of 3.37, has been pitching much better. He's making his 10th start. He has completed two games. Fastball, slider, curve, change of speeds is the name of his game. He does not try to overpower you. Wilcox has a record of 6-4. With an ERA of 3.84. He's 6'2", 215 pounds. He's 30 years old. He's made 14 starts, and boy, he's got seven complete games, so he's been doing some good pitching. He's also got one shutout. He's awful tough against the White Sox. He throws hard, 90-plus, good hard sliders, and when he keeps the ball down, he's tough to beat. So for the White Sox, Baumgarten on the mound. Behind the plate will be Kim. Milt Wilcox for Detroit. Behind the plate, it will be Lance Parrish. And we'll be right back with play-by-play action and Harry Caray from the center field bleachers this afternoon.
The On Deck Show has been brought to you by H&A Insurance. For car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance, call the people who live up to your expectations.
In Chicago, you're watching WSNS TV44.
A TV44 sports presentation. The Chicago White Sox are brought to you by the following participating advertisers. Old Milwaukee Beer, the beer that tastes as great as its name. Old Milwaukee Beer. Chevrolet and your local Chevy dealer. You're looking for the right car or truck. Right now, Chevy's got it. Just come and get it. True Value Hardware Stores. True Value. More than just a name, it's our way of doing business. Commonwealth Edison, providing you the power to grow. The Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Chicago will remind you to have a Coke and a smile and enjoy Chicago White Sox baseball. Interlake Incorporated, a Chicago-based company in metals and material handling, sponsoring White Sox baseball for 8 consecutive years. Rusty Jones and the over 2,500 new car dealers who offer Rusty Jones rust-proofing nationwide. Hello, Rusty Jones. Goodbye, Rusty Cars. Zenith System 3 Color TV with computer space command remote control. See your Zenith dealer for a demonstration. And by the Association of Chicagoland McDonald's Restaurants. Nobody can do it like McDonald's can.
Harry Caray out in the center field bleachers, and we have a fine crowd on both sides here, and they're yelling, "Hold that tiger!" What is your name?
Kathy Brummel.
Kathy, are you a White Sox fan?
Yeah.
Who's your favorite player?
Jim Morrison.
Jim Morrison. All right, your name?
Rhonda Paganis.
Are you a Sox fan?
No.
What kind of fan?
Tigers.
What are you?
Tiger fan, all right.
How come you're a Tiger fan?
Because I'm from Detroit, Michigan.
What's your name?
Brenda Paganis.
Thank you very much. What's your name?
Randy Angolo.
Randy, how old are you?
13.
13. Are you a ball player?
Yeah.
What position?
Left field.
Good. Thank you very much. What's your name, sir?
Joe Hernandez.
This is your daughter?
And this is Amber. First Sox game today.
Well, she's going
to
become a great...
Harry a big kiss.
All right. Okay.
All right.
Thanks very much. All right, we're going to talk to some other fans here. Now, get your hands back now. Get your hands back so they can see you. You can't beat fun at the old ballpark. What's your name?
Mark Hernandez.
Mark, are you any relation to this Hernandez we just talked to?
That's my brother, Joe.
Oh, and that's his daughter.
His daughter's paying.
How long have you been coming to South Dean?
No.
Today. Let me see that. Let me see what this is. Hey, goodbye. A towel. What's your name, son?
Joey Cartwright.
Where did you get that towel?
Down here.
Down here at the ballpark. All right, we'll be back following this message. Caray with Jimmy Piersall. We're out in the center field bleachers. A beautiful afternoon. It's Knights of Columbus Day. And we've just had pregame ceremonies involving the Knights of Columbus. The White Sox anxious to even up the series. The Detroit Tigers have just beaten the heck out of them. 9 out of 12 last year, 3 in a row this year, including last night's ball game, which was marked not only by the fact that Detroit won the game 5-3 in 11 innings, but we saw one of the greatest baseball fights of all time. Man, there were some punches hit. Ross Baumgarten has been pitching a tough luck all year long, taking his practice tosses for the White Sox. He's making his 10th start of the season and his first of the year against the Tigers. He doesn't have much to show for the fine pitching that he has provided of late. In the last 45 innings he's pitched, the White Sox have scored exactly 6 runs. In his last 8 starts, White Sox have scored more than 1 run only once. And that was in his last start in Cleveland when they got 3-4. So here we go. Jim Lantine, the left fielder, right-handed batter, leading it up. Nice crowd on hand. We're out here in the center field bleachers. Boy, this is the ideal place to be today. All you need is a little suntan lotion. Ross Baumgarten looking out, ready to pitch now. Lantine is hitting 214. He was hitless, nothing out of 4 yesterday. Ball right in there. Wow, look at this coming into the bleacher. Miss Chicago. Ball low and inside. The count is evened up. We're going to try to show you this pretty young lady. Swings and he misses. Two strikes and a ball. Doubleheader tomorrow, and it's helmet day. Remember, it's a 12:30 starting time. We'll be on at 12:15. Hey, struck him out. Lantine is out of there on strike. There you see the young lady going over to the other side of the bleacher. We got a full house. They don't let them sit in the center section because it obstructs the view of the hitter. Here's Alan Trammell, the shortstop, hitting 332. Nothing out of three last night. First pitch a little low and outside. The water is not running out here in center field. Can't take a shower today. Out here, that is. There's a strike call. Bob Jacobs, let's get a shot of Bob Jacobs here in the center field bleachers. Our assistant director, who's always in the booth with me. Strike call. The camera is pointed your way, Jake. Smile. There he is. Boy, I'd like to have his overflow. Strike three call. Two men up, two men down on strikes. Al Cowens is already in Detroit. He left this morning. There's a warrant for his arrest, as the White Sox have charged him with assault and battery. The league president suspended them only for 7 days. Two men are out. Here's Steve Kemp, the DH, hitting 297. There's a good shot of Baumgarten. Fastball high. Two men out, nobody on. Hey, the sun's gone behind a cloud. Foul back. The upper room church of the great provider here with a big group of underprivileged children. Reverend J.C. Cooper is here with a big group. Did it hit him or foul? Or did it hit his bat? I think it is bat. Foul tip strike. Watch a replay. Now there's Kemp ducking away, and I think it just hit the bat for a foul strike. Two strikes and a ball. Low and outside. John Rice, former American League umpire, who now works with Sid Olson, the county assessor's office, the recorder of deeds office, rather. Sid Olson out here today, too, by the way. 2-2 pitch. Ball three. The Old Timers Baseball Association is represented. John Rice is the president. There's a base hit in the center field. Kemp grounds a single to center. Now to bring up Lance Parrish, who homered on Britt Burns last night. 650 members of the Chicago Old Timers, 100 members of the Milwaukee Old Timers, guests of the White Sox, with their president John Rice here today. Parrish is batting 279, 9 homers, 39 runs batted in. Fastball high and outside. Beautiful day. Tigers won last night 5-3 in 11 inning. Low. There's a throw. Getting away. And Kemp advances to second base. We have LaMarr Johnson playing first. Morrison is at second. Cruz at short. Pryor playing third. So now Parrish has a man in scoring position. And Baumgarten wants to talk to the catcher, Bruce Kemp. We see what happened on that last play again. No replay on it. Chet Lemon right in front of us here. playing Parrish very deep in center field. They had a cut, and boy, what a wicked cut. Kemp on at second base. One man out. He singled the center and advanced on the air. Now the count is evened up, 2 balls, 2 strikes. Sun shining in its full glory again.
Yeah, the game is there.
Two balls, 2 strikes. Hey, ball three, that should be ball four, and it's a base on balls for Parry. And they have runners at first and second on. Here's John Wockenfuss. He had a homer last night on Britt Burns. Second game in a row that he's homered against Burns. Now he comes up against Baumgarten. Watch his unique batting stance of John Wockenfuss. A couple of lovely looking young ladies here from Grand Rapids, Michigan, who want to wish Jay Boone a happy birthday. There's a fastball up and inside. With Baumgarten struck out the first two men. Then Kemp singled the center, advanced on an error. Parrish is walked. And Wockenfuss is the hitter. Low and outside, ball two. Wockenfuss hitting .264. 8 homers, 24 runs batted in. 2 balls, no strikes. All three outside. There's a big banner go flying overhead, Jimmy. Can you read that? It says bald. Then it gives you the number to call. I marked it down, James. All four, the bases are loaded. He walked him on 4 pitches. And now the bases are loaded. With 2 out. And here's Champ Summer hitting .346. He got a big pinch hit driving in a run in the 11th inning last night. Some of the boys from Notre Dame are here. Tim Martin, Kevin Swain, and Mike Busk. A little huddle going on around the mound. All this started harmlessly enough. But now they're in a position to score. Bases loaded, 2 out. 50 members of the Sigma Tau Gamma fraternity from the University of Illinois are here today. Champ Summers, who used to be with the Cubs, the pit. Barely missed, low and outside. Can't afford to walk this guy. There's no place to put him. Inside, ball two. 2 balls, no strikes. Hard to understand baseball, isn't it? He's got perfect control, strikes out the first two guys. Now he's walked 2 men in a row. He's 2-0 on this guy. Fouls it off to the first base side. 2 men are out, bases are loaded. Ed Swain of the Knights of Columbus. Prominent in the pregame program today. The pitch. Fouled it back, he's caught up with him now. 2 balls, 2 strikes. The Mayer family from Oak Forest are sitting in the bleachers today. Big crowd out here. Two balls, two strikes. Barely missed. A little bit inside. Now he has gone to 3-2. The runners will be going. Three-two delivery. Hey, struck him out on a bad fit. And did you see Summer throw the bat up in the air? Over anxiously, he swung at what would have been ball four. So he struck out the side, no run. One hit, one error, three left. We go to the bottom of the first, no score. Harry Caray back in the center field bleachers. We have a banner right behind us here. It reads, Detroit Lightweight Punts. A lot of reaction. Randy Minkoff of UPI sitting here in the center field bleachers with us. He brought up a point. There's that sign. Randy, I didn't even think about it when I was talking to Sparky Anderson. But why wouldn't he fine Cowens for not running out the ball?
Well, as we talked about before, Harry, my gosh, it was the top of the 11th inning, a 3-3 game. He's got his number three hitter up. And it was the first or second inning, that's one thing. That's no excuse for what he did. But that guy didn't even run to first base. And I asked Anderson after the game, I said, are you going to fine your guy for not going to first base? And he really avoided the issue. I mean, that was a, you want your guy to get on base and to start a rally, and he just ran after the pitcher instead of going to first base.
So much of these platitudes, which are expressed in print, sometimes are come under the category headed by the initials BS.
Exactly. We know what that means.
Here we go at the bottom of the first inning. White Sox now facing Milt Wilcox, who used to be with the Cubs. This program is owned by WSNS TV through exclusive rights granted by the Chicago White Sox, telecast solely for the entertainment of our audience. Here's the first pitch of the ball game by Wilcox, and it's a little bit low to Thad Bosley, who's hitting 311. Any reproduction or other use of the play-by-play description in the account of this game without the express written consent of WSNS TV is prohibited. A ball and a strike on Bosley. Bosley had nothing out of five last night. His batting average dropped to 311 from 339. Beautiful day in the bleachers. There's a slider inside. Wilcox. Much traveled. He's been around with various clubs. He's 1-6, lost 4. Earned run average 3.84. Swings. And he misses. So the count now is evened up. Two balls, two strikes on Thad Bosley. Bosley with one homer this year, 9 RBI. Wilcox delivered. Slow curve. He struck him out swinging. Bosley missed a curveball coming into him. The Burbank National Little Leaguers, the first place Eagles, are here in the bleachers. Also, the Knights of Columbus from DeKalb, Illinois. And the Burkes and Hudek families enjoying the game. Here is Todd Crew, who was hit in the last five games. The only game he failed to hit in was the first one he played for the White Sox. Not only that, he's played errorless ball. Had three hits last night. First pitch is a curveball in there. A busload is here from Mishawaka, Indiana, the Athletic Association. Father and son and daughter group. There's a pitch a little bit outside. Mishawaka's right next door to Notre Dame, where they hope to have a great football season under Dan Devine this year. Strike call. Two strikes and a ball. One out. No score. The Tigers threaten with the bases loaded in the first.
Good about Cruz playing shortstop.
Here's a pitch lined, and the left field's going to be caught. Cruz lined hard to Lentine. Two men up, two men down, and here is Harold Baines batting .275. Five homers and 18 runs batted in. Yeah, Cruz looks like he's going to be around a long time.
Very impressive. Boy, you got to feel very good about him playing shortstop. It really solidifies that side of the infield. I think that's a great deal that Beck and Heeman made.
Here's Harold Baines, two out, nobody on. The pitch a little bit low. Two men are out, nobody on base. Kim and Christie are here from Orland Park. Was going to bunt the curveball in there. He took it for a strike call. Count evens up with a ball and a strike. 22 members of the Jimmy Piersall fan club from Pinchtown and Lakeside in Muskegon, Michigan. We're here, Jimmy. Here's the pitch on the way. Slow curve hit on the ground, easy out. Whitaker has it over to first. One, two, three, nothing in front. At the end of one inning, no score. Harry Caray back in the center field bleachers. No scores. We go into the top of the second. I'd like to welcome some people in the skybox of St. Faith Hope and Charity Church in the patio of the United States Steel Supply. In bullpen number one, Rich Pearson and friends. And bullpen number two, Joe Arce and friends, and John Seward, our great friend and fine sponsor, is also here with the group. So is Emmett O'Neill, the advertising executive, watching the ball game in center field. Here's Tom Brookens, who was kicked out of the ball game last night. That might have been first pitch, he fouled it back. Might have augured not well for what was to happen later. Al Cowens, after the fisticuffs, after fleeing to the security of the Tiger dugout, is banished from the game. Foul, strike two.
You know, people forgot about the home run that Wockenfuss hit, too. And in a dispute like that, all that got overshadowed when we had the fight in the 11th inning.
Brookens hitting .276. Very fast. One homer and 11 RBI. Hi. Leslie and Wendy are here. So's Ginger Rapsis. Now the pitch fouled off. Two strikes and a ball. Greetings to Bob Skeffington and Jerry Skeffington. The Skeff Distributing Company in Decatur. There's a pitch swung and he foul tipped. Two strikes and a ball. Boy, everybody, that is all the guys stripped to the waist here.
Except you and me. We're the only ones.
I was stripped until it came on TV. If we go on radio, I'm going to strip again. There's a pitch swung on. Ground ball to Cruz. He throws him out. The great arm in here. Cruz throws out Brooklyn. Randy Minkoff of UPI is sitting out here in the center field bleachers. Who's a lovely lady here?
Name's Lisa Shea. She works in town for Time Magazine and ABC.
Not only that, she's pretty.
That's what you notice first, you see.
One out, nobody on. And Dave Stegman playing center field. There she is, sitting with Emmett O'Neill. No, Dutchie, she's not really pretty. There's a
pitch. She's with me, that's it. Yeah.
And she's really with him. Dave Stegman hitting .173, two homers and seven RBI. Oh, they're flocking into the center field bleachers. The pitch. Bouncing ball foul off to the White Sox dugout side.
Harry, would you like to see him play more Saturday afternoon games?
I'd like to see him play more afternoon games.
I mean, this is, look at the good crowd, great weather.
Great for the kids.
Oh, it's a lot easier for the family to take their people out on a Saturday afternoon than it is sometimes at night.
But somehow the feeling is, and it's borne out by the attendance figures, the feeling is that the White Sox are not a day baseball park. Strangely enough, I don't know why that would be.
Well, look at the crowd today. I mean, this is
a crowd. There's a pitch foul. We played, I know when Stu Holcomb was the general manager of the White Sox, he initiated a regular schedule of Wednesday afternoon games, hoping to build up day attendance, but it just never worked.
Well, I guess the Cubs have, you know, that impact, but every once in a while, those businessman special lady days type thing, I think occasionally they would draw here, especially in the summer.
I think if they did it on a regular basis, they would draw. But just to do it one year for a couple of Wednesdays or Saturdays.
The only reason they have it today is because of the doubleheader tomorrow.
Yeah. There's a pitch foul back. Al Cowens is already back. There you see manager Tony La Russa. Cowens went back to Detroit. Some of Butch McGuire's customers are here today, sitting in the center field bleachers. There's a ground ball. It should be easy. Morrison. Hey, hurry. Got it. Stegman can go down the line pretty good. Two up, two down. And that will bring up Lou Whitaker. Sweet Lou, they call him, in Detroit.
You know, Harry, last night, a lot of people don't know this, but McPhail acted very quickly on that suspension of Cowens. They announced that at about 1 o'clock in the morning.
I wish he hadn't acted so quickly. Maybe if he'd have deliberated and meditated, the fine would have been bigger, and so would have the suspension.
That's a good point. Now, how could he have seen the tape of what happened that quickly and getting a complete report an hour and a half after the game?
I'm sure the umpires reported it to him immediately.
But he, you know, they could have seen the tape, and they could have actually seen what happened. And what was the rush to get something out at 1 o'clock in the morning?
I think... Now the pitch to Whitaker. Brownie's going to have to hurry. Watch that play. Got him! Good play on both sides. On LaMarr scooping the low throw up, and on Todd Cruz charging with a speedy Lou Whitaker going down the line, getting the ball away quickly. 1-2-3. Nothing across. We go to the bottom of the second. No score. Caray with Jimmy Piersall, Joe McConnell, and Rich King, all here at Comiskey Park. No scores. We go to the bottom of the second inning. We're out here in the center field bleachers, which is well jammed where they permit them to sit. They came out of the center field section where we're sitting because it obscures the view of the batter. They don't want to have any white shirts.
Now you tell me.
Well, they got you blocked off with a TV set.
Okay.
Here is LaMarr Johnson leading it off, hitting 274 for the year. Good well wishes to Mike Martin in Palos Hospital. His loving mother Barbara watching the game here. One ball, no strikes. No score. LaMarr hitting out of a wide straddle. That a cut and miss.
What do you think's happened to him?
Well, he still leads the club in RBIs.
He got a lot of those early
home runs. And he's really about a 275 hitter. Here's a pitch low and outside. Two balls and a strike. You know, if you put men on base enough times for LaMarr, he's going to drive his percentage home. But he's always, now here you got your cleanup hitter leading off. You don't want that to happen. You want him to come up with a couple men on.
I still can't figure out. I know Lemon's been in a slump, but don't you feel he's got a bad third on this team?
Lemon, anything but third. There's a pitch a little bit inside. You want your very best percentage hitter to bat third, and preferably a guy with some speed. who can score from first base on an extra base hit.
Do you think that puts any extra pressure on Baines being a rookie that he's batting third?
Nah, why? What's the difference? He swings and he fouls it off. I think that's a lot of baloney. The guy's a hitter. He's swinging at the first pitch anyway. He doesn't care what he's batting
well,
first.
That's the thing. He's swinging at the first pitch.
What's so the difference?
That's right. I agree on that point.
Three balls and a strike. If you get a hit on the first pitch, it counts as much if you get it on the fourth. Ball four, he walked him. There's the beginning. LaMarr Johnson gets a base on ball. And that will bring a Bobby Molinaro. Now here's a guy who's in a slump. The more they pitch him inside, the closer to the plate he gets. And he just keeps getting jammed and jammed and jammed.
He looks so good the first 4 or 5 weeks of the season, and then he just seemed to lose it right away on one of those road trips, and that was it. You got to have him hitting if this team's going to score runs.
Here now is Molinaro. We'll throw the first, the runner back. Marty Jelovic here from Gary, Indiana. Boy, they're paying LaMarr Johnson a heck of a compliment. Twice they've thrown over. Do they think he's going to steal?
He was three steps off. They were so surprised to see him three steps off that they threw back.
Now the pitch. Strike call. One strike and nothing. Bobby Molinaro's average has dropped to 286. Now 286 is a good average, but not when you've been hitting 350. It would indicate that you're hitting practically nothing to drop that far.
He was leading the league for a week or two.
That's true. The delivery. Swings and he misses. Boy, what a lovely day out here at center field. A doubleheader here tomorrow, a helmet day. First 18,000 youngsters. Accompanied by a paid adult will receive a White Sox helmet free. The Westchester youth group are here. The pitch by Wilcox. Why? Two strikes and a ball. Bobby Molinaro at the plate. Former American League umpire John Rice, president of the old timer. Here with a big group. Two strikes and a ball. That evens a count of 2-2.
You know, Harry, I grew up watching the ball games in the bleachers, and the fans have never sat out in the bleachers. They should at least once, because it is it's fun, and you get a different perspective from the game sitting out here.
I think you can see what the pitcher has better here than anywhere else in this ballpark. In any ballpark. There's a pitch swung on. Line drive in the center field off the shortstop's glove. And LaMarr will stop at second base. Trammell got his glove on that ball. Slowed it up. So we have runners at first and second. Watch the replay. See, the ball's hit right up the middle. The pitcher can't reach it. Now watch Trammell. Boy, he covers a world of ground. He just barely touches it. Trammell wants to talk to Wilcox now. Runners at first and second, nobody out. I'm surprised a number of ladies sitting out here in the center field bleacher.
About the few number or the large number?
Large number.
Oh, all right.
The number of large ladies, is it?
You said that, I did.
There's a pitch a little bit inside. One ball, no strikes on Lemon, hitting 260. Five homers, 24 runs batted in. He had a big clutch home run last night, but unfortunately, it just prolonged the agony.
You know, if he doesn't hit the home run, there's no fight.
But just think all the excitement we would have missed.
Think of the runners. Money it's cost Cowens.
Runners at first and second, nobody out. There's a strike call. They rarely bunt with Lemon. Jim Morrison on deck.
Why isn't he bunting? Is he doesn't, his mind just doesn't want the bunnies. He's just not interested in it? Or?
No, I think, well, look at it. He's down the lower end of the batting order. If he bunts him over. Tried to bunt it and hit him. First it hit a foul territory, then hit Lemon, and then rolled fair. It's a foul strike. You know, if he bunts him over, they walk Morrison to fill the bases and have Kim up there.
Listen, he's got
a replay on the attempted bunt. Looked more like he was bunting for a hit than actually for a sacrifice.
Third baseman's playing back pretty deep, even though
there's two strikes now. Boy, I tell you, they sell some beer in the center field bleacher. Two strikes and a ball. Chet Lemon digging in. Slices a high pop foul out of play. LaMarr, who's already all the way around third, will cut across the diamond. Doubleheader tomorrow. It's helmet day. Perfect weather is predicted again, just like today. It's 83 degrees. And absolutely gorgeous out here. Most of the fans are stripped to the waist. Two strikes on the ball. Time is gone. Milt Wilcox. Veteran right-hander. Lemon hitting out of a crouch. Oh, shit. Here's LaMarr tagging up, trying for third after the catch, and he makes it. Now you see Molinaro, very poor base running.
And no one was covering second base. He could have taken second base.
Here he could see LaMarr Johnson was tagging up. He should have been tagging up too. When LaMarr breaks, he can break.
Especially the Detroit infield didn't play that very well. They had the shortstop going over to the third. The second baseman was covering first base for some reason. The ball was clearly deep enough. I don't know what he was thinking about.
Well, as Jimmy says, he may steal a base for you, but he's not really a good base runner. So runners at first and third now. Here's Mars, the infield, playing back for a double play. The youngsters are chanting, we want to hit. What a day at the old ballpark. Well, third baseman knocks it down. Throws too late. And a runner scores. Brookens lost the double play. That ball was sharply hit. Let's see what they give him on it. Let's watch the replay. Morrison hit the ball very hard, right at Brookens. Now, if Brookens comes up, it'll be an easy double play. But the ball is hit a little sharply, and he can't feel it cleanly.
Should be an error.
See what they're going to call it. You know, this Detroit ball club doesn't make many errors. They call it a hit. And a run batted in for Morrison. 1-0 in favor of the White Sox.
Do you think that was a hit, Harry?
Well, the ball was sharply hit, and I thought it took a little bit of a bad bounce. I've seen balls called hits. It didn't deserve it, much less than that. Here is Kim falling off the first pitch.
And not when I've been scoring, right, Harry?
No, then let's see. Maybe they're going to call it an error. They're changing it. Yeah, they just changed it from a hit to an error. I heard you.
We stick together, Harry.
Here's Kim now. A ball and a strike. Now the Tigers have made. That's only their 34th error of the season. The White Sox have made 65, almost twice as many.
Haven't they stuck pretty much with the same infield most of the season, Detroit?
Oh, yeah.
I think that makes a difference when you've got the same guys in there every day.
There's a curve low and outside. 1-0. The White Sox lead. A ball game at the bottom of the second. Hey, Nancy. Are we going to try it in the seventh inning? Okay. Line drive. Right field, but it's foul. Kemp trying to go the other way. Line the ball foul. One thing about it, Nancy, when your voice is as bad as mine, you can sing in the center field bleachers as well as you can sing in the bathtub. Nancy Faust, who soon is going to be married. Those wedding bells are breaking up that old gang of mine. Kim Wedding, 2-2 pitch. Struck him out. Two gone. Here's Pryor. Pryor's wife, Michelle, still in the hospital, but recovering very nicely from that. Boy, what had to be a traumatic experience. She's riding the airport bus in Toronto. When the bus went out of control, the lady sitting next to her was killed. The driver, they had to cut him out of the bus. Here's a pitch to Pryor, and it's curveball outside. And Michelle Pryor's training, being an airline stewardess, she saw the accident coming and threw herself on the floor. And just to give you an idea what kind of a thoroughbred she is, she proceeded to help the other passengers off the bus. As injured as she was. Strike call.
You know, I'm afraid of flying. I'm not going to get on the bus now. I'm going to start taking the planes everywhere.
Well, I tell you, those airline buses are the safest transportation you can think of. And so much more reasonably priced. Bouncing ball foul. Mary Franz. To Poulos. Greeks all over the place. From Davenport. A big group here from Davenport. Strike three. Pryor called out on strike. One run. One hit, one error, two left. So, at the end of two, the White Sox won. Detroit, nothing. Harry Caray back in the center field bleachers. We're going now to the top of the third. It's 1-0 in favor of the White Sox. Jim Lantine leads it off. Well, the top of the batting order is up there again. Joe Cross from Stourbridge, England is here, having a great time. Pitch a little high. How you doing, Jake? Everything all right?
Okay.
Lean over here, gotta hear you.
The only problem is I didn't wear short pants like you did. I wore the long ones.
Hey, strike three call to Lantine. Hey, that's four strikeouts for Baumgarten. He walked two, struck out three, and allowed a hit in the first inning. Oh, look at the tan on that guy walking by. You can tell he's been sitting out here in the center field bleachers.
I don't think he has an indoor job here.
Hey, the water isn't on, but you can't take a shower today. Maybe we didn't pay the water bill.
People have gone by there, keep calling it.
Yeah, that was a great idea, Bill Bex. Allen Trammell hits a line drive to the right. Trammell singles to right. That'll bring up Steve Kemp. He singled in the first inning. Trammell, a fine fielding shortstop, is hitting 333 with three homers and 25 RBIs. A runner at first base, one out. Ball game in the third. 1-0 White Sox. Good strike call. Boy, a lot of youngsters from various little league teams wearing their uniforms here today. What a beautiful afternoon. There's a curve a little low. Can't beat fun at the old ballpark, friends. Bring the youngsters out tomorrow for the big doubleheader. It's helmet day. They'll get a free White Sox batting helmet. Pitch a little bit low and inside.
Harry, don't you think they're going to have to start with a set rotation pretty soon? I mean, including Baumgarten. You're going to have to go with four or five pitchers and then decide who you're going to keep in the bullpen. You can't let guys go 2 weeks between starts.
No, that's true. They brought up Guy Hoffman today. He was a bouncing ball. Morrison throws to second in time. Force off. Kemp forced travel from Morrison to Cruz. Guy Hoffman has been brought up, and Francisco Barrios has been optioned out to Iowa, where he'll get a chance to pitch more regularly. The White Sox realize their problem of having too many starting pitchers. Now Hoffman will give them. Hoffman will give them a left-handed relief pitcher out of the bullpen.
Barrios has to work every 4 or 5 days to get back in.
Here's Parrish now. The first pitch to him is high. Parrish walked his first time at bat. Everybody goes by that shower and pulls at it, but no water is forthcoming. There's a fastball outside.
You know, part of the problem could have been is when Barrios had the first two times he was out, he had good performances, and I think that made a might have fooled some people that he was coming back and he was ready, and he hasn't been the same since those first two games that he pitched in May.
Yeah, but even then, it was still 7 and 8 starters. You still can't. You just can't start that many young pitchers.
See, when Barrios came back, then they that really messed up the rotation, and it really hasn't been the same since the middle of May. He hasn't decided on which four or five guys he's going to go with regularly, and it's hurting everybody on the staff.
Two men are out, a runner at first. Ball game in the third inning. There's ball four. He walked. That's the third walk given up by Baumgarten. And Baumgarten, for a control pitcher, always seems to walk an awful lot of men. Baumgarten now has walked 24 men and struck out 26. Now that brings a dangerous man up there, John Wockenfuss. The curveball over the outside corner, a good pitch, a strike call.
Harry, I talked to Wockenfuss after the game yesterday, and he felt worse about that fight than anybody on either side. He was very apologetic and said he just didn't know why he lost control and got involved with it.
You know, there were a lot of members of the Tigers who felt the same way, but after all, it was their teammate, and they had to go. They had to back him up, although their heart might not have been in it. Here's the pitch. Strike call. Two strikes and a ball, two men on.
As I told you before the game, I couldn't believe one of the Tiger players was blaming the Sox because they've been in fights all season long for that fight last night. It's unbelievable.
Two strikes and a ball. thought he had that strike. Just missed the outside corner, according to Al Clark, the plate umpire. Mark Manning, channel 44 here in the center field bleacher. Pickoff play, but he doesn't throw. The runner was back. We have Kemp at second base, Parrish at first base. Two balls, two strikes on the hitter. John Wockenfuss just missed with a curve. Three balls, two strikes. The runners will be going now on a 3-2 pitch. There they go. Here it is. High pop fly. Ought to be out of the inning. Morrison calling for it to retire the side. No runs, one hit, no errors, two left. We go into the bottom of the third. White Sox 1, Detroit nothing.
White Sox Helmet Day is just one of the exciting things that happen on Sunday, June 22nd. Be one of the first 15,000 kids 14 and under with a paid adult and get a Sox helmet from Jack in the Box restaurants. And between games of the Chicago White Sox-Detroit Tigers doubleheader is the annual father-son-daughter game for the White Sox players and their kids. Sunday, June 22nd, Helmet Day and father-son-daughter game. Doubleheader starts at 12:30. It's a whole new ball game at Comiskey Park.
Harry Caray back in the center field bleachers. We go in the bottom of the third inning. Thad Bosley, who fanned his first time at bat, will be leading it off. Milt Wilcox has struck out three. He's allowed one run. That was unearned. He's walked one man, and he's given up only one hit. White Sox out in front. Here's Bosley trying to get something going. The pitch. Strike call. One strike and nothing. Fair ball swung. He fouled it off. That ball was right in on Bosley, and he pulled it foul. Two strikes and nothing. Sun really bearing down out here in the center field stand. Now the pitch just missed low on outside.
You keep that tan year round, don't you?
Well, I try. Sometimes I think it's merely a whiskey flush. Two strikes on the ball. Fouled it out of play. Beautiful afternoon. We must have close to 30,000 here with a big doubleheader coming up tomorrow. Line drive, center field. Base hit. Bounces away. Bosley's going to try for two. Here's a throw by Stegman. Save! Tried for a shoestring catch. Watch the replay. Low line drive into center field. See, Stegman can't get to it at all. It bounces way off his foot. And the left fielder, Lentin, recovers it and makes a good throw into second base. Just a little bit too late. Well, they got the water going now.
Is that a single in an error, you think?
He was trying to sacrifice. They got to give him a double all the way. He tried for a shoestring catch and failed. So it's a double leading off for Bosley. See, Cruz on the replay, you can see he's trying to duck away. Ball hits the back. Same kind of pitch. He gets away this time. And it's evened up at a ball and a strike. Man in scoring position.
Just doused the ice cream man over there.
They sell everything out here. Cotton balls, ice cream, tacos, hot dog, chicken. Line drive right out. One hopper to the third baseman. Boy, a low line drive, a one hop right to Brookens. He fired over to first base for the out. So now here's Baines. Cruz again hit the ball hard. And now Baines will have a chance of driving in the run. Baines bounced out his first time.
So important to get that run over, runner over to third base, though, Harry.
Really? Where a fly ball could score.
Yeah, a fly ball scores a run now, and now it takes a base hit.
Fastball to high. Baines with five homers, 18 runs batted in. Rolled out his first time. The pitch a little bit outside. Two balls, no strikes, one out. 1-0 White Sox. Boy, oh boy, that shower is working and they're lining up to use it.
Wonder if the water's cold.
Oh, you do. You can bet it's cold. I've been in it. Two balls, no strikes. Harold Baines trying to get the run off. He had a cut. Fouls it off. Two balls and a strike on Baines with one out. Man in scoring position. Doubleheader tomorrow. It's helmet day starting at 12:30. We'll be with you at 12:15. Baseball with your breakfast tomorrow or Sunday brunch.
You know, Harry, I'd never been to that picnic area before. It's behind the right field, left field bleachers. That is really something.
It really is. You can get anything you want down there. Three balls and a strike. He swung at a bad pitch. And that makes the count full at 3-2. This is something that Baines is going to have to learn. It's going to come only with experience. Have to learn to know the strike zone a little better. He swings a lot of bad pitches.
He's going to get that by playing every day. That's the only way he's going to be able to overcome that.
3-2 pitch. Fouled back. Wilcox with a good slider and a good fastball. Three balls, two strikes. One man out, a runner in scoring position. Boy, the field looks terrific. Grass just as green as it can be. The pitch. Ground ball to the first baseman. He's got it. Steps on the bag for the out. Wockenfuss took care of Baines' ground ball. Bosley goes to third, but now there are two out. And here's LaMarr Johnson, who walked his first time up.
You know, the outfield looks like it's in much better shape from center field than it does in the press box.
Two men are out. Runner at third. Ball game in the third inning. 1-0 White Sox. Not a single given. There's a fly ball deep center field, but Stegman is there to retire the side. The leadoff double was wasted. No runs, one hit, no errors, one left. This is Harry Caray. We're going to be moving over to radio out here in center field. The score at the end of three innings, the White Sox 1, Detroit nothing.
This is WSNS TV44 in Chicago.
Hello again, everyone. Joe McConnell speaking to you on a beautiful afternoon here at Comiskey Park. Boy, if you haven't made any plans for tomorrow, come on out and see these two ball clubs play a pair, along with the fathers, sons, and daughters game between games here tomorrow. 1-0, the White Sox leading the Tigers as we move along to the fourth inning. Champ Summers, who helped us out, striking out at a bad ball with the bases loaded and two out the first inning, leading it off. Inside the ball. Ross has fanned four, three of them looking. The only swinging strike three was Summers. He's also walked three, giving up two hits, no runs. High fly ball down the left field line. Long run for Bosley. And it hangs up for him, and he gloves it just in fair territory. One out. Summers going the opposite way. Here's Tommy Brookens, who bounced to short, leading off the second for the Tigers. He was ejected in last night's ball game after one at bat protesting a called third strike. The ball too low. George Hendrick of the Cardinals is in his 14th home run of the year in the fourth with nobody on. St. Louis now has a 3-1 lead after 3.5 at Cincinnati. There's a ball, again too low. 2-0 the count. Cardinals have played a little bit better since Whitey Herzog took over, but they're still in the basement. There's a knee-high strike, 2-1. Side ball three. Ground ball to Cruz at short. Two out. Here's Dave Stegman, the center fielder. He bounced out to Jimmy Morrison, his previous at bat. He's 0-4 this year against the White Sox. Each club with two hits and an error, the White Sox have the only run. Ball one. There's a fastball strike, 1-1 the count. I'm sure Harry has made reference to it, but I'm just as amazed as anybody else that Cowens has not received more than a 7-day suspension for that altercation here last night. Ball two and strike one, the count. The rookie center fielder Dave Stegman. I got to think a lot more is going to come out of that. If not, they're just inviting the same thing again. Ball three, count it in. I would have thought a month at the very least for unprovoked attack like that. Ground ball up the middle. Cruz dies, knocks it down. Morrison can't get it. It'll be a hit. Well, there's a case where if Jimmy Morrison is late breaking over there, he takes the ball and maybe has a chance for the play at first. But he's hustling too, and he just wasn't in position to get that deflection off Cruz's glove. Couldn't quite close the glove on it. Whoops. Here's Lou Whitaker, who rolled out to the shortstop Todd Cruz in the second inning. Two out, Stegman on at first. Strike, a beauty, a slider. Moved him away from the plate. 0-1. Cubs are in Atlanta again tonight. They'll try to make it four wins in a row. Good to see them winning again. Inside fastball. Max Whitaker out of there. 1-1 the count. Well, the Angels just came up with three runs in their half of the third inning at Fenway, and they've taken a 3-2 lead over the Red Sox. The Twins batting in the bottom of the fifth at the Met lead Cleveland 1-0. Last night they played 15 innings before Cleveland won it 14-3. Strike three! Got him looking at a curveball, backing him away. Five strikeouts, and that's a season high for Ross Baumgarten. No runs, one hit, one left. We played 3.5 here at Comiskey Park in Chicago. Look at Whitaker bailing out there. The score, the White Sox 1, and the Tigers nothing.
I'm Gritz Gresham, inviting you to watch exciting sports action on Sports the Field each Saturday at 4, right here on TV44.
Stay tuned following today's game for Sports the Field, the magazine format sports show that explores the great outdoors. In today's episode, a featured visit to a bison range in Montana and an interview with a world casting champion fisherman. That's following today's game here on TV44. Here's Bobby Montanaro, singled up the middle for the first hit of the ball game of the White Sox in that run-producing second inning. 1-for-1 today. Now he has three hits in his last official 26 trips to the plate. Sox leading at 1-0. We're in the bottom of the fourth. Milt Wilcox against Ross Baumgarten. Both pitchers have looked plenty sharp. Slider and a called strike, a beauty. Brookens playing in on the edge of the grass at third. High and away, 1-1. Up and in, ball two. Cleveland got a run in their half of the fifth to tie the Twins. One all. Minnesota now batting in the bottom of the fifth at the Met. Now Jimmy Spencer has hit a two-run shot, his fifth of the year in the first inning. He had a home run last night. There's a drive down the left field line, but it's going to hook foul. 2-2. So the Yankees have a 3-1 lead over Oakland after one at Yankee Stadium. New York trying to make it 9 wins in a row. The Yankees have won 2 out of every 3 they've played this year. They're 42-21, the best record in baseball. Quite frankly, I didn't think with our home-and-home series against the Yankees early in the year they were going to be that formidable. Oh! Swing and a miss on a changeup. Parrish dropped the ball. He throws him out at first. Boy, what a pitch that was. Four strikeouts for Wilcox. He completely fooled Molinaro. That's only the sixth time Bobby's fanned this year. Two-three put out on that strikeout. Here's Chet Lemon in a deep fly to left center, his first time up. He went for an inside fastball and chops it down and back. 1-1 to Chet, batting with one out in the bottom of the fourth inning. Sox leading 1-0. Changeup just missed, ball two and strike one. Fouled off to the third base side. Two balls, two strikes to Chet Lemon. Well, there have been 9 strikeouts in this ballgame so far. 5 for Ross and 4 for Wilcox. Bouncer to Brookens. 2 out. So Chet bounces out third to first. Here's Jimmy Morrison, who reached on Brookens' error first inning, but he did get credit for an RBI. That Brookens fielded that hard one hopper. I'm sure the Tigers would have turned the inning-ending double play. As it was, the White Sox got the run. Ground ball again to Brookens, who digs it out belt high, throws him out. 3 up and 3 down in the fourth inning for the White Sox against Milt Wilcox. So we've completed 4 innings here on a beautiful day at Comiskey Park. 1-0, the White Sox over Detroit. Don't forget, Jimmy Connors plays Vijay Amitrage in a round-robin match in the $200,000 WCT Invitational tonight at 8 on World Championship Tennis right here on TV44. Here's Lantine leading off the fifth for the Tigers. Strike call. He has looked at 2 called third strikes in his 2 trips up today, both knee-high sliders. Fastball strike 2 at the Mutters. Going 2 to Lantine, who's yet to swing a bat. Up and away, ball, 1-2 the count. Ball bounce to the shortstop Cruz. He charges. Got him. One out. Here's Alan Trammell, who looked at a called third strike in the first and hit a soft line single in the right his last time up. Tigers at 3 hits, the White Sox 2. The White Sox have the only run here in the fifth inning. Each club with 1 error. Sparky Anderson in the Tiger dugout. Center. Bosley, long run. Can't get it. Bounced off the top of the fence. Lemon fields it. Trammell going to third with a triple. Well, we'll take another look at that. It looked like Bosley had a chance to catch the ball. Now, I'm not sure whether he had trouble tracking it in the sun or not, but it dropped just over his head. It bounced up high off that fence out there. And Trammell, with good speed, just legged out his 4th triple of the year. Bosley turned away from that ball. I think he lost it in the sun. That was a tough chance, but it should have been caught. So a triple with 1 out. Just missed inside with a slider. Ball 1. The 4th hit off Ross Baumgarten. Swing and a miss. What Ross needs right now is 2 more of those. Still 3-2 California. Red Sox batting in the bottom of the 4th at Boston's Fenway Park. The Twins got to run right back in their half of the 5th, and they lead Cleveland 2-1 after 5. Hit to right. The game is tied. Kemp just knocks in his 34th run of the year. The Tigers are on the board. comes Lance Parrish. Congratulations all around for Alan Trammell. Ross got that curveball right out over the plate. Kemp stayed with it. One out, a run is in. Kemp on it first. Has walked both times today. Strike two, a beauty. Ross took something off of that breaking ball. To the count on Lance Parrish. Almost threw it away. Kim blocked the ball. One ball and two strikes. His swing. Baumgarten thought he had a strike there. Now the first base coach Dick Trzuski has a word with Steve Kemp, the runner. 2-2 the count. Lance Parrish checking with Alex Grammas at third. We're in the top of the fifth inning. The Tigers have just tied it on the one-out triple by Trammell and a run-scoring single by Kemp. A drive to left. That's in there for extra bases. Bouncing up against the fence. Parrish into second with a double, and the Tigers have runners at second and third. A triple, a single, and now a double in succession here, and Ross is in big trouble. That's the 14th double of the year for Parrish. Three successive hits. Now the Tigers have a chance to take the lead at six hits all told off Baumgarten. There's LaMarr Hoyt loosening up in the Sox pen. He got a victory at Cleveland the last game the Sox won. Swing and a miss to Wockenfuss. Strike one. Doing a burn. He thought he had a strike past Parrish. One and one to count to Wockenfuss. Kemp on at third. Parrish takes his lead at second. Breaking ball into the dirt. Ball two and strike one. Get a run batted in, however. thought for a minute Cruz is going to try to get the runner at home. He looked there. Then he decided to make the play himself. Freezing Parrish tried to scramble out of the way. So a fielder's choice and an RBI for Wockenfuss, who's safe at first. Two out. A run is in. Two runs in the inning. The Tigers lead it by a run. Strike one. Champ Summers has struck out and flied to left. Self-defense and anything else. I don't think he ever did break his wrist, but he turned all the way through the pitch. One ball and two strikes. That was up and in, right under his chin. Take another look at that. Looked like Summers almost snapped something inside his ribcage on that one. Foul back. Just got a piece of it. One ball and two strikes to count. About the oddest looking swing I've ever seen. He may have pulled a muscle in his neck the way he was trying to hold back in that swing, but he went all the way around. Well, they've got the runner picked off. Oh, they call a balk. Another balk on Ross Baumgarten, and Wockenfuss is awarded second. We've had a number of these. Inside. They don't have a stat for the number of balks, but I got to think that's about the second one on Ross. Pop fly down the left field line. Fire chasing it and gloves it. Nice play, Greg. That retires the side, but two runs score on three hits. One man left. Baumgarten talking things over now. The umpire, the home plate umpire, Al Clark, before he goes to the dugout. Well, we reached the halfway point here at Comiskey Park on an ideal baseball day weather-wise. The score, the Tigers 2, the White Sox 1. Well, let's see if we can pick up that illegal move, the balk that was called on Ross Baumgarten. That there's a stretch. Oh, he didn't step towards first base. You've got to step towards the base. He went into his stretch. He hesitated and then threw to first without making a move towards first. Here's Bruce Kemp, who struck out his first time up. Ground ball in the hole into left field. A leadoff single here in the bottom of the fifth for Kemp. His second hit in the series. It's only the third hit of the ballgame for the Sox, and the tying run is aboard with nobody out. Detroit is out hitting the White Sox 6-3 right now. Pryor checking with third base coach Bobby Winkle to see if he's going to be ordered to lay down a bunt here. Well, you want to make your plans now for the big 4th of July weekend here at Comiskey Park. Starting on Thursday night the 3rd, the Sox will start the celebration with a special fireworks show following the Sox-Angels game. On the 4th of July, the Sox will play the Oakland A's in a day game with a special July 4th show from Six Flags Amusement Park. There's a bunt foul on the first base side. That's on July 4th, the amusement show from Six Flags Amusement Park following the single day game in Oakland. On Saturday, the 5th of July, the White Sox and the A's will play another afternoon game and will welcome a special visitor from Santa's Village. Then on Sunday, the 6th, Banner Day at Comiskey Park, and the Banner Parade will be on the field between games of the doubleheader with Oakland. That's the 4th of July holiday weekend celebration at Comiskey Park. Tickets for all the upcoming home games on sale now at the box office. Bruce Kemp batting with, or rather, Pryor batting with Kemp on at first. Strike one to come. Greg fouls it off again. Two strikes. He's failed twice now to bunt. Two to count. Now, hopefully, Greg's wife Michelle will be out of the hospital tomorrow. Look at Kemp on it first. Wockenfuss says, "Go ahead and take your lead." Wilcox stepped off the rubber. Two strikes on Pryor. Well, at San Francisco this afternoon, it'll be Lurch, 2-8 for the Phillies against Ed Whitson, 4-7 for the Giants. Foul ball pop up. Wockenfuss should have a play on it. He does. One out. And the Sox failed to advance the runner. Bosley, the leadoff batter, is up. He is struck out and doubled. The ball that could have just as easily been ruled a hit and an error. The center fielder, Stegman, tried to short hop it. Bounced off his leg and caromed all the way over to where the left fielder then teammate to play, and it was actually close at second. Wilcox goes to first. Kim is back. This might be the warmest day of the year here at Comiskey Park. Beautiful day. A lot of sun worshippers out in the center field bleachers. Fastball strike on one to Thad. Bosley checked his swing just in time. It was up and away. 1-1 the count. Kravick and Wortham will pitch for the White Sox in the double dip tomorrow against right-handers Morris, Jack Morris, and Dave Rosema for the Tigers. After 6 at the Met in Bloomington, the Twins a 2-1 lead over the Cleveland Indians. And in the National League, after 5 at Cincinnati, the Reds trailing the Cardinals 3-1. Too many games this afternoon. California, the Angels still leading the Red Sox in the top of the 5th at Fenway, 3-2. The Yankees in the bottom of the 2nd at New York leading the A's, 3-1. Spencer's 3-run homer got the Yankees a lead in the first inning. Bosley pops it in the shallow left near the line. Long run. It drops for a hit. Runners on at first and second. Texas League pop-up. Just barely in fair territory. Well, that'll look like a smash in the line score or the box score tomorrow. The old tradition goes. So the White Sox have 2 hits in the inning, 4 for the afternoon. The catcher Lance Parrish out talking things over with Wilcox as Cruz comes up. The tying run, Bruce Kemp at second base. And the lead run, Bosley at first now. One out. Cruz has been swinging a hot bat, although he's 0-2 today. He lined hard to the left fielder Lentine back in the first inning. Time to change up curve beautifully, but hit it too well. Bounce to Brookens at third in the third inning. Strike, good fastball. There's Bosley. Kemp taking his lead at second. Milt Wilcox, 30-year-old right-hander, born in Honolulu, trying to pitch his way out of trouble here in the fifth. He has a one-run lead. Way outside, 1-1. Todd Cruz, the batter, five-game hitting streak at the moment. But it's going to hang up. The catch is made by Champ Summers. The runners will hold at first and second. So there are two out, and here's Harold Baines, who has an 11-gamer, and he's 0-2. He has rolled out to Whitaker at second, bounced out to Wockenfuss at first the last time, up 0-2. I'll tell you, a long ball now would look mighty nice. Now, Al Clark, the home plate umpire, coming out to speed things up between the catcher, Lance Parrish, and the pitcher, Milt Wilcox. I think they decided where they were going to eat tonight. Two on, two out here at the bottom of the fifth. Tigers lead by a run. Fastball inside, ball one. Big swing on a fastball for a strike, 1-1. Minute to get out of the way of that one. Ball three, blown inside. Well, another bad one would load them up for LaMarr Johnson. LaMarr Johnson digs in with a bases loaded and two outs. Now this is where the White Sox need to hit, and this is where the hot clubs always deliver, but the White Sox have been unable to get their hits in timely fashion for well over a month, and that's why they've been struggling here. Johnson leads the club in homers and RBIs. He's the guy you want up there. Ground ball to third. Brookens to second for the force play, and the Sox leave the bases loaded. No runs, two hits, a walk, and three left on. We've completed five here at Chicago. 2-1, Detroit leading the White Sox.
The White Sox will celebrate the 4th of July with a special fireworks show on July 3rd following the Sox-California game. Hi, everybody. I'm Joe McConnell, inviting you to join the White Sox in their July 4th celebration.
will light up the sky with fireworks and fun on Thursday night, July 3rd. And then you'll want to be on hand as the Sox take on the Oakland A's Friday, July 4th, in an afternoon game beginning at 1:15. Get your tickets for the special fireworks show on July 3rd and for the afternoon game in Oakland here on July 4th. Tickets are on sale at the Comiskey Park box office, Sox ticket outlets, and ticket drugs. Moving along to the top of the sixth inning, the Tigers by a run. Detroit has left seven men on base. The White Sox have left six runners stranded. Brookens, Stegman, and Whitaker, the bottom third of the order, to face Ross Baumgarten here in the sixth. Ball one, down and in. Brookens has bounced out to Cruz at short twice. Forget, July 5th will be a special day for all you youngsters here at Comiskey Park. Christmas in July. How that? St. Nick himself will be here along with the Santa's Village Singers, all from Santa's winter home, Santa's Village in Dundee, Illinois. You youngsters can bring your Christmas letters early and deliver them to St. Nick yourself. In addition, everyone who attends the Sox A's afternoon game will receive a coupon good for one half off admission at Santa's Village Amusement Park. It's Saturday afternoon, July 5th. The A's and the White Sox here. High pop-up. Morrison gives way to Baines in shallow right, and he takes it for the out. Here's Stegman, who has reached on an infield hit his last time up. He rolled out to Morrison at second back in the second inning. He's one for two. Dave Stegman. Tigers have out hit the White Sox 6-4. Outscored us 2-1, each club with an error. In the sixth. Strain. 1-1. The Indians failed to score in the top of the seventh at the Met in Bloomington. The Twins lead it 2-1. After five at Fenway, the California Angels lead the Red Sox of Boston 3-2. Inside, ball two and strike one. The A's tied up the Yankees with a deuce in the third. It's now, I'll make that 4-3 New York. Yankees got one in the bottom of the second. They're now in the bottom of the 30 Yankee Stadium, 4-3 New York. A bluff bunt and a call strike knee high to Stegman. 2-2 to count. Ball in the shallow center. Chet Lemon, the long run. He makes the throw. The ball drops. He wheels the throw back into Todd Cruz. It'll be a bloop double for Steg, but it looked like Lemon made that sliding, skidding catch out there. Let's take another look at that. The high shallow pop into shallow center field. Here comes Chet. Morrison gives way. Dropped right in front of him. Saw a one-out bloop double to center by Stegman. The eighth, I think of the seventh hit off Ross. Whitaker 0 for 2. He struck out the last time up, bailing out on a curveball. He bounced to short his first time up. Low, ball one. Yankees failed at Yankee Stadium there after the third. So it's 4-3 New York after three over Oakland. Ball two. Down low. Is throwing again in the Sox bullpen. Three and oh, the count to Lou Whitaker. He walked him. That's the fourth walk of the ball game for Ross Baumgarten. It comes at a bad time. That's the guy you want to get out, a left-handed batter. Runners at first and second, one out. And the leadoff batter, Jimmy Lentine, is up. He has struck out twice and bounced to short. Sox are hoping for the double play here. Foul back. Like a bass drum, that ball hitting the screen. Lentine 0 for 3 today. Now one hit in 14 at bats against the White Sox this year. Strike two. Good slider. Ross has really had some good stuff against this guy. To the count. Ball one, it's high. Tigers trying to break this one open in the sixth. They lead by a run, 2-1. They have runners on at first and second, one out. There's Whitaker at first. Curveball low and away. Ball two and strike two now to Jim Lentine. Catch by somebody in the upper deck just below the press area. 2-2 the count. Fly ball to left center. Lemon cruising over. Two out, the runner's hold. Here's Trammell. He has been tough today. And here comes Tony out of the dugout. Trammell has struck out, singled and tripled, and scored one of the two Tiger runs. But Tony's going to have a word with Ross Baumgarten before he faces the Tiger shortstop. Detroit leading it 2-1 here in the top of the sixth inning with two on and two out. Clark, the home plate umpire, coming out to bust up this conference between Kim Baumgarten and the manager, Tony La Russa. The Twins have added a third run in their half of the seventh and now lead Cleveland 3-1 after seven. Man. Here comes Trammell, 2-for-3. Just came up from Des Moines as the left-hander warming up in the bullpen along with Hoyt, with LaMarr Hoyt. Swinging strike two to Trammell. Good pitch. Well, one more and Ross can wriggle off the hook here in the sixth. Tigers have already left seven men on base. They've got two more on at the moment. Bluff throw to second. Fortunately for Rossi, it stepped off the rubber that time. Rice steps off again. Two strikes, the count on shortstop Alan Trammell. 6 strikeouts in the game. Good slider. And the Tigers leave 2 men on. 1 hit, a walk. And after 5.5, the Tigers still lead by a run, 2-1.
In Chicago, you're watching WSNS TV44.
2-1, Tigers leading it. There's the score as we go to the bottom of the 6th. Molinaro, Chet Lemon, Jimmy Morrison, the bat for the Sox here against Milt Wilcox. Don't forget, it's Connors and Armitage in a round-robin match in the $200,000 WCT Invitational tonight at 8 on World Championship Tennis here on TV44. Jimmy and VJ. Wilcox has given up only 4 hits. Walk 2 in 5 innings. The 1 run scored on an error, although it is earned. White Sox left the bases loaded in the 5th against this guy. Tigers have stranded 9. The White Sox have stranded 6. One foul out of play. He is singled and struck out. Wilcox fanned him on a beautiful off-speed pitch the last time up. Ball outside. 1-1 to Molinaro. Up foul territory. Brookens in front of the Sox dugout takes it for the out. You think he'd have had a helping hand in there today? I doubt it. So there's one out. Here's Chet Lemon, who has fly deep to center and bounced to third in 2 trips. Despite his home run in the ninth of the man on that tied it last night, Chet continues to struggle at the plate. So far, it's been just one of those years. Fastball strike on the outside corner, belt high. Bullpen down there. Artie Kushner, the bullpen catcher. Kush caught a couple of jabs of that ball last night, one from Champ Summers. Inside fastball, 1-2 to Chet. Also appeared that Hebner hit him. 1 ball, 2 strikes, Chet Lemon the batter. 2-1, Tigers leading here in the home half of the 6th inning. I can't recall the last run the Sox had scored when I was working a TV game. There's a fly ball down the left field line, foul. We haven't scored many at all, but I can't recall the Sox getting a run in the middle 3 innings in a while. Cox is ready. The 1-2 pitch. Foul ball again. Nice grab by a fan sitting in the first row in the lower boxes. Oh, Whitaker, near second, throws him out. Wilcox may have touched that ball. So there are two out. And Morrison will be the batter. Take another look at that, see if the pitcher, Wilcox, actually got a tip of the glove on it. No. Came close. Thanks to our replay, the scorer was able to rule that a 4-3 putout. Here's Morrison, his RBI, the only game for the Sox. Strike. He reached when Brookens booted his ball to third. That scored the run. He bounced to Brookens the last time up, so Jimmy is 0-2. Twins batting in the bottom of the eighth at home against Cleveland, leading 3-1. There's a changeup outside, 1-1. Oakland failed in the top of the fourth at Yankee Stadium. New York leading Oakland 4-3. They're in the top of the sixth at Fenway Park. The Angels lead the Red Sox 3-2. Those are the only other games going on this afternoon in the American League. Off-speed curveball inside, 2-1 to Morrison. Over in the National League, the Phillies failed to score against Whitson in the first inning at San Francisco. Ground ball hit to the shortstop Trammell. He's up with it. Low throw, but dug out by Wockenfuss at first, and the White Sox go down 1-2-3 in the sixth. Well, Harry out in center field. We'll be back to take you the rest of the way here this afternoon on TV 44. But after six here at Comiskey Park, there's the score. The Tigers 2, the White Sox 1.
Harry Caray back in the center field bleachers. Boy, it is hot out there. Take a picture of them, the great fans here. Let's turn that camera around. Let's get a picture of those pretty people there. All right, we're going to the top of the seventh. The score, 2-1 in favor of Detroit. Here's Bruce Kemp. Here's that banner, Detroit lightweight punks. Well, those lightweight punks are doing pretty well. Come on, let's get a few runs. I don't think it makes any difference who's pitching. The way we're hitting, everybody looks like a Hall of Famer. I know we got better hitters than that. Let's hold them and get some run. Here's Kemp. He drove in a big run for them in the fifth inning. Greetings from Chris and Randy to Jerry Boone in Grand Rapids. Two balls and a strike to count on Steve Kemp. Boy, I want you to know, Nancy, you sound just as good out here in center field as you do in the stand. You are beautiful. The batter, two balls and a strike. Now the pitch by Baumgarten a little below. Greetings to our friend Bill Ezrin, who handled our radio phase of the In the Bleachers broadcast. Look out, hit by a pitch ball. Yep, hit by a pitch ball. Kemp is hit by a pitch ball. Watch the replay. He's trying to spin out of the way. Just barely hit him a glancing blow. Good thing it isn't Al Cowens. We'd have a big fight. Runner at first base, nobody out. Here's Wockenfuss now. He drove in a run. The run to put him ahead in the fifth. There's a strike call. Baumgarten is having the same kind of luck that's plagued him all year. His last five starts, he's given up only five earned runs. Yet doesn't have a victory to show for it. Pitch is fouled out of play.
Funny how those shirts fit these gals after they come out of the shower. Seems to be, they seem to be misshaped. 2-1 in favor of Detroit. The pitch. The breaking ball is low. One ball, no strikes. There's George the photographer. The pitch. High pop foul out of play. Baumgarten would love to have a double play here. Be sure to stay with us for Jimmy's post-game show. Need to be following the game. Now the pitch. There goes the runner. There's the peg. Way late and way back. Stolen base for Kemp. Bad a. All the Baumgarten, the left-hander. Kemp seemed to have a good jump. And the throw by Kemp was nothing to write home about. That's only the 35th stolen base for the Tigers. There's a high pop fly now. Bosley waiting for it in short left field. Makes the cut. One away. Parrish flies out to Bosley and left. And that will bring up Wockenfuss, who drove in a run in the fifth. Kemp started the inning being hit by a pitch ball. Stole second. Has held there while Parrish flied out. And here is dangerous John Wockenfuss. Here's the stretch. He had a good cut and he fouled it back. Wockenfuss in the hole. A dangerous right-handed batter. The curve a little high. The White Sox have made only one run on four hits, committed an error. Tigers have had two runs, seven hits have made an error. There's a line drive left field. Bosley coming in. It's a base hit. There's a run racing for the plate. The throw, safe. The throw was online. On the throw to the plate, Wockenfuss goes to second. Again, Wockenfuss has come through. And now the Tigers lead 3-1. 28,162 paid here today. Another big crowd. Doubleheader tomorrow. There's no chance for Bosley to get the runner at the plate. His throw was offline. And it enabled Wockenfuss to advance to second base. So a run is in. It's 3-1. And things aren't looking any better. White Sox just haven't been able to hit their weight. And they're claiming the runner missed third, but it is not allowed. Al Clark's the plate umpire. Steve Palermo's at third base. Phillips at second. Morrison at first. Here now is Cham Summers, and the strike is gone. One strike and nothing. A couple of these young fans have that crying towel of the White Sox. It's the na 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 hey 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 crying towel. It's on sale here in the ballpark. One in favor of Detroit. Now Baumgarten's pitch. swings, and he jammed him. A little pop foul. Pryor over. Can't reach it. Two strikes or nothing. One man out. One run in. A runner at second base. And the ball game's in the seventh. Kim talking to Baumgarten. Looking ahead to the bottom of the seventh, we'll have the lower end of the batting order. It'll be Kim, Pryor, and Bosley in that order, unless we have some pinch hitter. Here's the pitch. A little bit low. Champ Summers, the hitter. He's 0 for 3 today. Baumgarten is ready. The pitch. High pop fly. Baines under the ball. Makes the catch. The runner holds it second. With a runner at second and one out, the White Sox elected to pitch to the dangerous John Wockenfuss. He singled the left to drive in the run. Now the left-handed batter, Summers, pops up. There's two gone. Here's Brookens. He's 0 for 3 today. He's a right-hand hitter. 3-1 in favor of the Detroit Tigers. Here's a pitch swung on. A bouncing ball foul outside third base. Alex Gramas, who used to be a pretty good shortstop in the Major League, coaching at third base. Alex played short for the Reds, for the Cardinals mostly, and other club. Bouncing ball foul. So he's ahead of Brookens, two strikes and nothing. Top of the seventh, Detroit lead. Brookens, a tough little hitter, batting 276. Here's the pitch. Fastball. Outside. Two strikes and a ball. Boy, they have so many different colored jerseys here. There's a pitch outside. Hey, Jimmy, here's one for you. Here's a t-shirt that reads, "Stay Demented." Two balls, two strikes. I'd ask him for the shirt, but he's an awfully big, burly guy. There's a pitch foul out of play. 3-1 Detroit. When are we going to have a rally? Two balls, two strikes. Boy, jammed him with a fastball, and Brookens just barely got a piece of the ball. Two balls, two strikes. 2 men are out here in the top of the seventh. A run is in with Detroit out in front, 3-1. They've out hit the White Sox. 8-4. Red hot sun bearing down. Oh, it must be close to 90 degrees. Here's the pitch. There's a line drive in the center field, a base hit. Here's a man trying to score, the throw to the plate. Gets by everybody, rolls to the screen. The batter now is on his way to third base. It'll be a hit and an error on Lemon. 4-1 now. On the replay, you'll see a solid base hit to center field. Lemon charges the ball. He knows the runner Wockenfuss is not too fast. He figured he'd have a play for him. But the throw was wide by the cutoff man, by the catcher, and by Baumgarten diving for the ball. And here comes Tony La Russa. That's going to be all for Ross Baumgarten. We'll tell you more about LaMarr Hoyt following this message.
WBMX FM 103 is always a relief, because if you're looking for hits, we bring them to you. BMX FM 103, where you're always safe. Whether you just want to lay back and listen, or you really want to blow it out, stay with WBMX FM 103 and check out the White Sox.
LaMarr Hoyt, who won in his first appearance in the major leagues the other night in Cleveland. Hoyt comes in. He's pitched 2 2/3 innings, allowed 3 hits and no run. Dave Stegman will be the first man to face him. Ross Baumgarten deserved a better fate. He allowed 9 hits. Some of them could have been prevented, especially the triple that led to their 2 runs in the 5th. He's charged with 4 runs, and the responsibility for the man on 3rd belongs to him also. He got 2 hits, 2 runs in this inning. Stegman had a cut at the first pitch. Forward to 1 now in favor of the Tigers, shooting for the 4th consecutive victory over the White Sox this year, with a doubleheader to go tomorrow. Stegman had a cut and miss. 2 strikes and nothing. We're in the top of the 7th. LaMarr Hoyt. Curveball outside. Crowd of almost 30,000 here today. They haven't seen much to get excited about yet. He struck him out. 2 runs, 2 hits. 1 error, 1 left. We go into the bottom of the 7th. The score: Detroit 4, White Sox 1. All right. Okay, Nancy. Everybody! Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Buy me some peanuts, fat kerchief. I don't care if I ever get back on it. Root, root for the White Sox. If they don't win, it's a shame. Oh, it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. Hey!
Watch the Jack Benny Memorial Tennis Classic with host Dr. Henry Kissinger and Dinah Shore Saturday night at 7 on WSNS TV44 Chicago.
We go into the bottom of the 7th, and the White Sox haven't had anything resembling a big inning in a long time. We got 2 runs in the 9th inning last night on Lemon's home run that tied up the ball game. The night before, they'd made only 1 run in going to the 3rd inning when the game was rained out. In the doubleheader in Toronto, they made 4 runs in 1 inning and got beat 5-4. In the 2nd game, they made only 1 run. Here's Bruce Kim to lead it off. Rick Peters is now playing center field, place of Stegman. Only 3 behind. Wilcox has allowed only 4 hits. doing her best to try to get a rally started. There's a looping fly ball, short center field, may drop, and it does. Base hit. Kemp gets his second hit, a single to center. Here's Pryor now. There's a good beginning. Squires is going to bat for him. Squires will bat for Pryor. Squires is hitting 276. A runner at first, nobody out. Well, we get another base runner and things can shape up. Fastball outside. Wilcox is 30 years old from Honolulu, Hawaii. Came up originally with Cincinnati, then with Cleveland. Then he was with the Cubs. This is his fourth year with the Tigers. Strike call. He's a big right-hander, 185 pounder, 30 years old. A ball and a strike. Fouls it back and out of play. Two strikes and the ball. Aurelio Lopez warming up. Takes it. One away. And that will bring up the leadoff man, Pat Bosler. One out, one on. If Bosley can get on there, you'd have the tying run coming to the plate. You know about that word if. Bosley's two out of three. The pitch is inside. I don't know. I didn't know the gals went for the shower. It's what did they do? There's a strike call. The count is even up. I guess it does something to their figures. A ball and a strike. Into the dirt. Fred Bosley. Two balls and a strike. 28,000 plus here paid. Up two balls, two strikes. One on, one out. We're in the seventh. Popped it up on the infield. Bosley pops to Whitaker. That's two away. Here now is Todd Cruz, hitless in three tries. Wilcox making the White Sox hitters look rather impotent. Now the pitch swung, and he hits a high pop foul. Catcher going to go over. Parrish, no play. 2 minutes around. Kim is at first base. Ball game in the bottom of the seventh. They start the doubleheader at 12:30 tomorrow. We'll be with you at 12:15 for the pregame. Shot to left field, but it's going to be caught. Right to Lentine. Cruz lines hard. No runs, one hit, no errors. One left. At the end of seven, it's Detroit 4, the White Sox 1. Caray back at the ballpark. We're going into the eighth inning. The Tigers are leading 4-1. Here's Lou Whitaker to lead it off. High fly ball. Bosley in left field. Grabs it out, number one. That will bring up Jim Lentine. He's nothing out of four. Lentine was nothing out of four last night as the leadoff man, and he still won their ball game. Today he's nothing out of four, but his team's still leading. There's a pitch a little bit inside. That's when things are going good. When your leadoff man doesn't get on base, still you win. One out, nobody on. LaMarr Hoyt in relief. Team hitting out of a crouch, draws ball four. That's the first man to reach base against White. Ross Baumgarten has had only one victory, but has pitched well enough to have a number more. Had another one of those typical games where he pitches just good enough to lose, it would appear, although this game isn't over yet. White Sox trail only by three. Throw to first, the runner back. LaMarr Hoyt. Pitch out. Not going anywhere. You know, Bruce Kim has a... He must be a bad guesser on that pitch out or something. Rarely is he called one right when something's going on. There's a pitch a little bit high. Now the pitcher's in the hole. Two balls, no strikes. Better than 28,000 paid. White Sox already two under 500, still in second place. Hit and run, there's a smash to the third baseman. Kevin Bell throws over to first for the out. Bell now playing third. Pryor went out for a pinch hitter. Bell throws out Trammell. Lentine taking second. Here's Steve Kemp. He's had two out of three. They're going to walk Kemp intentionally to get to Parrish. So an intentional pass to Kemp. Matrona Malik of Channel 44 here with her camera. Taking a lot of pictures of the crew. Probably going to save them for pay TV, which is scheduled to go, I think, in September, late September, or first of September. Boy, just think of pay TV. If that had been here last night, you could have sat at home, paid the price, and watched the big fight between Leonard and Durant. It's going to be a whole new ballgame once they get that cable and pay TV. Look what they're doing out here in the center field bleacher. A funnel of beer cups. Matrona goes over to take some pictures. Maybe we'll get our own cameraman to take a shot. Here's Parrish now. Fouls the first pitch off. They got a great big funnel of beer cups formed out here in center field. Can we show it? There you see it. Ah, you can't beat fun at the old ballpark. Lance Parrish was one out of two, walked twice, singled, and flat out. Walked twice, doubled, and flat out. Curveball low. Boy, I don't know how these Tigers are in last place. Every time we see them, they look terrific. There's a smash to Cruz. Out at second, out at first. Double play. Parrish hits into a double play. 6-4-3. No runs, no hits, no errors. One left. We go to the bottom of the eighth. The score. Detroit 4, White Sox 1. Good. Okay. Shower, you think it isn't getting these guys with the tower of cups are heading for the shower now. We go to the bottom of the eighth. The White Sox need some run. Here's Harold Baines now. There go the tower of cups. Heading for that shower. There's Baines taking the first pitch low. One ball, no strikes. Nobody on, nobody out. Strike. Oh. Out twice. The White Sox have only made five hits. Here's the pitch to Baines. Swung on, bouncing ball. Wockenfuss gives it to Wilcox in time. One away. One gone, here's LaMarr Johnson. White Sox just haven't been able to generate any offense. Five hits, one run, and that run was unearned. just in time from Brookens to Wockenfuss. So Johnson rolls out. Two men up, two men down. Here's Bobby Molinaro. He's one out of three. $28,162 paid here today. They have Rick Peters playing center. Cam Summers is still in right. Jim Lantine in left. Jimmy will have his postgame show coming up. There's a ground ball, easy out. 1-2-3, nothing to it, is there? At the end of eight, it remains Detroit 4, White Sox 1. John Wockenfuss is going to lead it off here on the top of the ninth for Detroit. Detroit leading 4-1. Wockenfuss has driven in two of their four runs. Tigers have made four runs on nine hits. If they hold this lead, they'll be at the 500 mark. Now the delivery by LaMarr Hoyt. Right in there, a beauty of strike call. Hoyt has pitched an inning in the third without being scored on. Marks his second good appearance for him. Wockenfuss the hitter. Look at that funny stance. Really wraps his front toe around his rear foot. Doubleheader tomorrow. We'll be with you at 12:15 here on Channel 44. Bob Jacobs out here in the center field bleachers with us. Popped it up. Lennon is there in short center. One out. Rick Peters, who replaced Summers in the lineup, will bat for the first time. Stegman stayed in the ballgame, moving to right field to replace Summers last inning. Lantine is in left, Peters now in center. One out, Peters the hitter. He drove in a run last night. Switch hitter takes the pitch in there for a strike call. Peters batting only 202. One homer, seven RBI. There's a foul ball down the first baseline. One out, nobody on. I tell you, between the shower and the cold beer, I don't think these fans much care what the score is. They're having a good time. And that's what it's all about. Sure, a lot more fun, though, if you're winning. One out, nobody on. Curveball low and outside. One man out. We're in the top of the ninth. Wide again. Two balls, two strikes, one away. This is really remarkable. They sit here and they think of things to do to amuse each other. Listen to them. Two balls, two strikes. There's a ground ball to Morrison. Two men gone. Two men are out. Well, we got the fans. Now all we need is a ball club. Our fans got to be among the greatest in the world. Their approach to the game is one of let's have a good time. There's a smash base hit. Brookens singles to left. That's his second hit. That's the first one off of LaMarr Hoyt. Ross Baumgarten had hoped to win his second victory of the year, but it doesn't look as if he's going to be so destined. There goes a run of the pack. Boy, look at that. They, even the Tigers, who are not known for their speed, steal at will. Brookens stole second. Watch the replay. Now, Kim seemed to get the ball away quickly, but there's nothing to the throw. Just floated down there. This Dave Stegman, he's 2 out of 4. Out of play. 4-1 in favor of Detroit. They won in 11 innings, 5-3 last night. White Sox just in one of those ruts where they can't get any hits put together. That's what means a slump. They struck him out swinging. No runs, one hit, no errors, one left. We go to the bottom of the ninth. The White Sox need 3 to tie. These fans haven't given up. The score going to the bottom of the ninth, Detroit 4, White Sox 1. We go to the bottom of the ninth. The White Sox are trailing 4-1. They've scored one run and not unearned. A big crowd here in the bleachers. Chet Lemon. A couple of base runners and a long one. That's all it takes. Lemon is 0-3. Boy, you can't beat fun at the old ballpark, but it sure would help to win a couple, too. Called. Lemon in the hole. Nice play by Brookens behind the bag, long peg, and he is up. Brookens throws on Lemon. One away here in the ninth. Watch a replay. Now watch Brookens behind the bag. Now he still has plenty of time. Lemon diving in. I don't know what how much time he saves doing that. One out, nobody on. We're in the ninth. The score 4-1. Morrison is 0-3. Her ball a little bit outside. Let's see what Wilcox has done in the way of complete game. two down. Wilcox is going for his eighth complete game. Eighth complete game in 14 starts. Well, that's pretty good pitching. His earned run average, very respectable, 3.84. He's shooting for his seventh victory of the year. It's all Detroit. White Sox have made one run that unearned. Boy, and Detroit's supposed to have weak pitching. You'd never know it, the four games they played the White Sox. Two balls, no strikes on Kim. Kim has two out of three. He has two of the five hits. And Bosley has two of the five hits. The only other hit was by Molinaro. That's not much hitting, is it? Will it stay in play? Wockenfuss can't reach it. The White Sox have had five hits. Only one was an extra base hit, and that was when the center fielder tried for a shoestring catch. That too would have been only a single if he played it safely. Tigers have had 10 hits good for four runs. Two men out, nobody on. There's a drive foul. Boy, these fans are so hungry to hear anything. Even a loud foul, they cheer. Just haven't done a thing. Got to give Milt Wilcox a lot of credit for that, 30-year-old right-hander. Bruce Kemp, the batter, two out of three. We're within 10 minutes of a three-hour game. The old ball game. And Brookens makes the catch. 1-2-3, nothing across. The Tigers are still unbeaten against the White Sox. Four in a row. We'll be back with the totals and highlights following this message. Where's he going? Well, what is there to say? Just got beat. But he only scored one run and that unearned. There's not very much opportunity to win the ball game. And meanwhile, the Detroit Tigers, who beat the White Sox 9 out of 12 last year, have now beaten them the first four in a row this year. So that's 13 victories in 16 games. So I would say that they certainly have a hex on the White Sox. So far this year, they have just simply stopped the White Sox hitting completely, which seems a little strange because the only weakness, according to the Tigers, is that they don't have any pitching. Well, you'd have a tough time convincing the Chicago White Sox of that. The totals are four runs, 10 hits, and one error for the Detroit Tigers. Milt Wilcox, pitching his eighth complete game of the year in 14 starts, is the winning pitcher. He now has won 7 and lost 4. For the White Sox, one run, that unearned, 5 hits, 2 errors. The loser, Ross Baumgarten, he now has won 1 and lost 2. Tomorrow afternoon, starting at 12:30, and we'll be on the air with you with the pregame at 12:15,
It'll be a doubleheader, and it'll be helmet day. And youngsters, if you're accompanied by a paid adult, you'll receive free a Chicago White Sox batting helmet. This ball game today for the Tigers represents a milestone. They have reached the 500 mark, and it's been a long struggle for them. So now they are at 500. For the White Sox, they're now three under 500. It seems only a couple of weeks ago, they were seven over. So maybe tomorrow in the doubleheader, they can do something about reversing what is becoming a trend. Don't go away now. Jimmy Piersall will have an interesting post-game guest coming up in a moment. I want to thank all these wonderful fans out here at the center field bleachers for being the great fans they are. We've had an opportunity to have a lot of fun with them out here, and we've enjoyed it. I hope they have too. Bob Jacobs, my good right hand here in the bleachers with me. Now this is Harry Caray wishing on a very pleasant good afternoon from the center field bleachers, where the Detroit Tigers beat the Chicago White Sox 4-1. See tomorrow afternoon at 12:15. Don't go away. Jimmy will be coming along in a moment. So long, everybody.
The Chicago White Sox have been brought to you by the following participating advertisers. Schlitz, the one beer brewed for men who've tasted gusto and know there'll never be a better beer than Schlitz. Go for it. Chevrolet and your local Chevy dealers. If you're looking for the right car or truck right now, Chevy's got it. Just come and get it. True Value Hardware Stores. True Value. More than just a name, it's our way of doing business. Commonwealth Edison, providing you the power to grow. Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Chicago, bottlers of Coke, Tab, Sprite, and Fresca. Have a Coke and a smile. Interlake Incorporated, a Chicago-based company in metals and material handling, sponsoring White Sox baseball for 8 consecutive years. Rusty Jones and the over 2,500 new car dealers who offer Rusty Jones rust-proofing nationwide. Hello, Rusty Jones. Goodbye, Rusty Cars. Zenith System 3 Color TV with computer space command remote control. See your Zenith dealer for a demonstration. And by the Association of Chicagoland McDonald's Restaurants. Nobody can do it like McDonald's can. A TV 44 sports presentation.
This game is copyrighted by the Chicago White Sox.
This is WSNS TV 44 in Chicago.
It's time for the Baseball Report Show featuring Jimmy Piersall. Baseball Report is brought to you by your greater Chicago area Toyota dealers.
Jimmy Piersall back in the ballpark. The White Sox lose it to Detroit again. They just have an awful lot of trouble with that Detroit ball club. My guest, Ed Farmer, who had quite a night last night, probably one of the worst fights I've ever seen in my life. You know, Ed, throughout the years, I've always maintained that guys in sports generally get in a fight, they fight each other. They certainly don't come up from behind. You must have really standing there, and all of a sudden somebody's behind you. What was happening? I couldn't really tell.
Well, yeah, I was watching Todd Cruz with the ball. My first reaction was, what's he doing with the ball? Did Collins fall down? And then I heard someone say, look out. And I looked out of the corner of my eyes, I saw him, just out of the corner of my left eye. And I just bent down a little bit, and he went over. He grabbed me. He stuck his finger in my nose, and he scratched my nose right here. I mean,
he's a bugger snatcher. That's
I guess, you know, it.
It really surprised you. It was something.
Oh, sure.
I imagine you have expected him to do something sooner or later, whether covering first base on a bunt or something along these lines, because when you hit him in Texas, and I got to believe this too in my heart, that it's awfully hard for a pitcher to deliberately hit somebody on the head or a face because it's the easiest place to get out of the way.
The only spot that you can hit somebody is in the back or in the rib cage. For somebody to get hit in the face or in the head, they've got to be looking for a ball in a certain area, which is not inside. That ball was inside, and it wasn't really that far inside. He got
hit.
He's up on top of the plate like most of the Kansas City hitters, and he goes into the ball. He went into the ball all right, but he went in instead of with his bat, he went in with his face, so he got a broken jaw out of it. Last night, he more or less put a nail in his own coffin.
Well, you know, let me ask you this now. Had he been hollering at you from the bench, or had you faced him before last night anywhere else?
No, see, that would show some kind of guts. Mr. Cowens has no guts. To me, he's gutless. I ran by him in Detroit a few times, and he didn't say a word to me. Then he snuck up behind me. They better check the Detroit Police Department better keep an eye on him. He may be snatching purses today in downtown Detroit out of a dark alley somewhere.
We'll be right back with Ed Farmer right after this message. Ed, I don't understand the suspension of 7 days. Usually, the president of the league has to look at pictures. He has to get the report for the umpires. I don't know whether he was protecting this young man to get him out of town before he got himself in a whale of trouble. I know when I was in a fight in the stands in Baltimore, they took me to jail, and then they wound up going to court. That took 4 days, and finally the judge fined the guy $750 and said he had no right calling my mother names or anybody of that nature. But just think what would have happened if they had put me in jail for 5 or 10 days.
Well, you know, I grew up here on the South Side, and I have a lot of friends here on the South Side that come down to the games. I mean, I think that Lee McPhail... And Mr. Collins is concerned. He did the right thing, because I'm sure some of my friends were out here today at the ballpark, and the next time they come into town, I'll have no control over them. I don't know what they're going to do to them, but the fans here, they bagged me 100%, and I love them for that. And I don't know what's going to happen to Al Cowens.
It's usually when there's a fight on the field, the next day it's over, unless it's really something awfully bad. But generally there's a fight. How many times have you had a hitter come to the mound after you or go near you? If you have a few punches swung, it's all over the next day.
Jimmy, I'm 6'5". For somebody to come to the mound, and I've taken some self-defense classes. I was coming back from arm surgery. I had to work out with a boxer. And for someone to come to the mound, it's against a guy 6'5". He's got to have his head examined. So that's the first guy that's ever come out.
What are you looking at me for? I'm not going to come out.
That's the first guy that's ever come out,
sick,
and that's the first guy that's ever come out behind me.
Well, let's say this. You don't feel anything for the worst. You feel good. There isn't anything bothering you except that little scratch in your nose.
He scratched my nose. If I knew he was going to do that, I'd have walked up and said, I have an itch here on my face. Can you itch it for me?
Well, I'm going to give you a razor, Ed, to shave yourself. It's one of the better razors around the country. But now, right now, you feel pretty good, though. You're not really bitter about anything right at the moment. But if you see the guy again, then there could be trouble.
Well, I can't say that. You know, I've got to come out and do my job. Naturally, I'm going to tell him something when I see him the next time in Detroit.
He could have ruined a good year for you, couldn't he?
Yeah, he could have ruined a good year. I thought I gave him a good year. I gave him a little rest there from May 8th till June 10th. He was out 2 months. He finished strong. He's off AstroTurf now, and he's hitting what I thought he'd hit, about 250.
You know, one thing about baseball and the players on your ball club, it just seems like when something like this happens, it looked to me like there was 4 or 5 guys out there right away. Were they trying to climb on top of this guy, or were they trying to get him off? What were they doing?
Well, see, what happened was he came over my shoulders, and as I was going down, I spun over, and I was laying on top of him. These guys came, my teammates came out, and they just pummeled him. Two or three guys just nailed him. He was over sitting on the bench. He was away from everything. You know, that's about his style. He was over there sitting on the bench, just taking it easy. You know, he's protecting his average. It's 2.5. You've got to do those things.
Well, you and Durant had a good night. Of course, you didn't get as tired as he did, but by the looks of things, you may win. Are you going to sue this guy or what?
Well, we're going to California, my family and I, tomorrow night. And I just ended a lawsuit against an individual that hit me in an automobile. And I didn't think I'd be talking to my attorney quite this
you got him on retainer?
Quickly. Yeah, he'll be on retainer starting Monday.
Oh. Well, look, you've had a super year so far. Things are going pretty well. I guess all you're going to worry about right now is us starting to win some ball games and you get the pitch.
I want us to start playing a little better baseball than what we did.
You got a better club than we're playing.
Yes,
right
sir.
Now.
I want us to come out tomorrow and give the fans what they expect, a sweep of a doubleheader tomorrow.
28,000 here today. These fans are great, aren't they?
They're the greatest.
Good. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for watching. Don't forget, tomorrow we play at 12:30. Harry's On Deck show is 12:15, a doubleheader to these same two ball clubs. So if you get a chance, come on out and watch them. I'm Jimmy Piersall saying thanks for watching.
Guests on the Baseball Report Show will receive the rechargeable Eltron Interstate Shaver by Braun AG, featuring a compact cover unit that's a combination travel case with wall bracket, charger, and cleaning brush. It's from Henry K. Jewelers at 547 North Michigan Avenue and on the third level of Water Tower Place. This has been the Baseball Report Show. Baseball Report has been brought to you by your greater Chicago area Toyota dealers. The previous public service announcement has been brought to you through the courtesy of Household Finance Corporation.